Hello everyone, I'm your teacher for the day, Saira Raza, and today we are going to do this wonderful poem by Pablo Neruda called Keeping Quiet. The title brings many questions to your mind. What does the poet want you to understand from the title Keeping Quiet? Does he want you to be reclusive? Or does he want you to be alienated? Or there is a more deeper and profound meaning to the title? Well, students, Pablo Neruda has touched on a very, very sensitive nerve, which is applicable even today. He is talking about giving a few moments to introspection and thought before unreasonably attacking nature, attacking people, and destroying this wonderful environment that God Almighty has blessed us with. Before we get to the actual text, let's quickly see and in depth what this great person was all about. Pablo Neruda got his name from the Czechoslovakian poet Jan Neruda, but he was actually born in Parral, Chile, and his name was Ricardo Naftali Regis Rosolto. And Pablo Neruda, which he adopted the name, was much admired for his various professions. I must say that he was a man who had amazing facets to his personality. He was not a man who was simply a poet, a linguist, a diplomat. Pablo Neruda, of course, was a prolific writer. And we will touch on the fact that he wrote on various genres. But apart from that, Pablo Neruda was a great human being who fought for peace and he wrote extensively. Another aspect of his personality was that he was tilted towards the Chilean Communist Party and he had very strong political views. So, a poet, a diplomat, and a politician. What a versatile man, I must say. Amongst his writing, Pablo Neruda actually started writing students at the age of 13. And it was then that his mentor realized what an amazing writer he was and started training Pablo Neruda. Pablo Neruda wrote extensively and he was not simply experimenting, but I would say that he had actually mastered the various genres. He wrote an epic, a huge epic, covering the entire Latin America, talking about the lives and cultures, and even prophesizing the future of the Latin Americans. He wrote fluently love poems, and I must say he got a lot of admiration and adulation for his love poems, and he was pretty ingenious. And of course, he wrote even political manifestos. So he was an amazing man, children. He was born on 12th July 1904, and he lived till 23rd September 1973. There were many people who wanted to applaud his work and actually bring him to a stature of he could be also be termed as the national poet of Chile. And amongst some of the awards that he received, he got the International Peace Prize. He also got the Lenin Peace Award. And of course, we are all familiar that Pablo Neruda was honored with the prestigious Nobel Prize for Literature. And none other than Marques Gabriel said in as many words that Pablo Neruda could be simply termed as the greatest poet of the 20th century in any language. Now, coming to his involvement in life, children, there were two points which we can see playing up time and again in all his works. And those two points were that he was extremely distraught with the destruction that war brings on mankind. And he was averse to this whole concept of fighting thoughtlessly wars and destroying beautiful places. In fact, when he was a diplomat in Spain, and he wrote extensively for the Spanish Civil War. And what did he write? He wrote time and again in that lovely poem, if I recollect, I want to tell you a few things. He actually says how beautiful Spain was before war and how destructive the war was, that it had destroyed to the very roots, not only the ethnicity of the country, but also the natural beauty. So we can say then that Pablo Neruda was a man who was a pacifist. And another thing, he was, I told you that he had a platform, a political platform, which he used very often for his open views. He was very strong in his views. In fact, when the communist regime changed and General Pinochet, the dictator, came to Chile, he hounded Pablo Neruda. Unfortunately, Pablo Neruda had to even escape to Buenos Aires, and then he came back. And it is sad that in the later years of his life, it was found out that he was suffering from cancer. And it was then that he was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, and actually his literature award, which kind of elaborated in his peace values. He did great service to the human beings and a great man indeed. I would like to now touch on some of the very, very well quoted lines. His love poems, I told you, brought him a lot of popularity. 20 love poems he wrote, and in that he is extremely witty. I can almost feel like wanting to compare him to the metaphysical poet centuries back, John Donne. And he says in one of his poems, very wittily, he's telling his lady love that if you are thinking of leaving me, by the time the thought comes to you, I would have already left you. There's another line which is very oft quoted, which says that I want to do to you what the spring does to the cherry trees. And we all know, especially in the valley, we know about the beautiful cherry blossoms and how it has matured into a fruit-giving tree after the spring. And I also want to bring another point to your mind, students, and that is that another image, or should I say another symbol, which keeps reoccurring in the poems of Pablo Neruda is none other than spring. Spring was a symbol of optimism for this great poet. Spring was, he saw spring as a symbol of change, and he firmly believed that, you know, you can cut the flowers. Beautiful lines from one of his great works. You can cut the flowers, but you cannot stop the spring from coming. Which he indirectly was trying to tell the people that no matter what you do, however strongly you try to suppress the voice of dissent, however many efforts you try to trying to put them, to stop them. But eventually, dissent is very, very positive, because it is only the voices which criticize, which improve the society. And he firmly believed that, and he wrote at a time when Chile was going through the atrocities of the dictator Pinochet, General Pinochet, I mentioned, and Pablo Neruda said that, you know, we should not become hopeless. Hopeless was something he was never. He said that let us not become hopeless. What we need to do is to look at the nature around, and we will realize that change is inevitable. That you can cut the flowers, but spring will come. And sooner or later, the change is going to be for the better. So he was extremely optimistic, a great writer, a great human being who spent many years in exile and is applauded and appreciated and looked up to with a huge amount of reverence, not only in Chile, but the world over, even today. Now let us look at the poem, students. The poem begins with these beautiful lines. Now I will count to 12 and we will all keep still. The best way to understand this poem is, if you recollect, I think all of us have played this childhood game of statue. Imagine if I said 1, 2, 3, statue. Imagine, students, if the entire world went statue. What peace! No rush, no murder, no cutting of the trees, no attacking the wildlife. What a wonderful place the world would be. Pablo Neruda says that now understand that let us begin with counting 12. What does he mean by 12? 12 simply means a few moments of introspection. And what you see in these lines, children, there is a wonderful poetic device which the poet has used, and this is called antithesis. What is an antithesis? An antithesis is putting two opposite thoughts together. So what are the two opposite thoughts? And now I will count, which is doing something, and we will all keep still. So the two opposites he has brought together, and by saying that we will keep still, he does not in any moment of time mean that we should not do anything. What he means is that we should give only a few moments in our life to introspection. And looking at the world around today's students, the kind of attack, the kind of war, every nation is busy flexing its muscles. Every nation is waiting to attack, to kill. No one believes in the value and the strength and the power of speech and words, and that is why it is so wonderful. What makes the poet Pablo Neruda so relevant to today's time is that something which he said 50 years back, students, is applicable even today. Even today, we are thoughtlessly moving on like mechanical tools. We are thoughtlessly moving on, only trying to be smart, trying to achieve our dreams and not looking at the destruction and the harm we are causing all around. Now moving on with the text. For once on the face of this earth, very beautifully, Pablo Neruda says, for once on the face of this earth, let us not speak in any language. What an epigrammatical line, students. Let us not speak in any language. Why is he saying this? Even though languages were created, as we know, languages were created to connect the people, to communicate, to bring us closer to our fellow human beings. But today we see the moment people speak, we find that prejudices start coming within us. The moment someone speaks like an American, we say, oh, this man is an American. He must be chauvinistic. They are like frogs in the well. We have these preconceived ideas about people. The moment a person speaks with an Arabic pronunciation, we have different connotations. We connect them to the land. But children, if you do go and if you do have an opportunity someday, if you are there for the Christmas Mass in Vatican City, and or if you have had the good fortune of attending a huge religious ceremony, a yoga ceremony, you realize as long as we do not speak, it does not matter which part of the country we are. We suddenly realize when we are quiet that the person sitting next to me is none other than a fellow being, that we are all wrapped with the same universal spirit of brotherhood. And the moment we speak, the prejudices start coming up. And hence Pablo Neruda says that let us not speak in any language. I want you to focus that the word language is also a poetic device which is used. And what is that? It is metonymy. Students, what do you understand by metonymy? Metonymy is when a word works as a symbol and it goes to a much larger connotation. Here the word language works as a figure of speech called metonymy, because language also means culture, race, traditions, all connected to a specific language. So let us pause for a moment and let us not move our arms so much. Why is he saying let us not move our arms so much? Students, you need to understand that what Pablo Neruda is trying to tell us, that arms, there is a pun intended, another figure of speech. And what is the pun intended? The pun intended is arms on the one hand is physically moving your arms. Why is he saying don't move your arms so much? Because how often do we now use our arms for any positive activity? We do not use our arms for anything positive. How often do we run on the road and extend our arm to help a man who is visually impaired to make him cross the road, or pick up a child who's fallen down or give him a hug? How often do we use our arms for something positive? Every time we use it, we are using it for something destructive. And that is why Pablo Neruda has used this word beautifully. Let us not use our arms so much. I told you there is a pun intended on the word. And what is the second meaning of the word? Arms also means your weapons, children. He is trying to tell the governments, he's talking to the policy makers, he's talking to the people who inflict pain and atrocity and brutality on the human beings of the world, that, you know, if you transcend over your broader lines, you realize that the human beings are the same across. It's we who create the discrimination, and let us not use our arms so much. Let us stop this whole idea of war. I told you how destroyed he was when he was in Spain, and eventually he was even sent back because he kept writing about the destructive annihilation, the heinous crimes during war, and he says that let us not use our arms so much. Neruda goes on to say, and when we stop for a few moments of introspection, what is going to happen? It is going to be a moment which he terms as an exotic moment. So he says it will be an exotic moment without rush, without engines. And what will happen then? We will all be together in a sudden togetherness, a sudden strange togetherness. What is he trying to say, students? Please understand that on the surface these lines look pretty simple, but there is lot of impact, there is lot of philosophy, there is lot of compassion and humanism in these lines. And he's saying that when we stop for a few moments, what is going to be happen? It is going to be an exotic moment. Why will it be an exotic moment? These questions will keep coming to your mind. Yes, it's going to be an exotic moment, because when we stop for a few moments, we will realize that no matter who is sitting next to me, it can be a white man, it can be a Japanese, it can be a Latin American, it can be a Pakistani, whoever sits next to me, we are all part of the same universal spirit of brotherhood, and we have no business to discriminate or have any kind of prejudices. And why is he calling this kind of a togetherness, sudden togetherness, strange? Why has Pablo Neruda used this word strange? Why is this feeling strange? Because we have never ever felt like this. We have always been divided. We grow up divided, students. We are kind of indoctrinated with ideals which divide us. We need to transcend over the borders of a state, over the borders of a country, and we need to become global citizen. And that strangeness, you will realize, the moment we do not use any language, the moment we do not talk, we will realize that yes, the man next to me on the right hand side or on the left hand side is no other than just another human being who God Almighty has created, and we are part of the same beautiful plan created by the Almighty himself. And then what else will happen? So on the one hand, we are talking about no war, and then what is going to happen? It will also be exotic, because the whole environment, which is subjugated to so much of abuse, we have learned from very young age that how the environment is struggling, the trees are struggling to give us enough oxygen to breathe, and we see our cities choking students the world over. And then you have something like the Amazon fires, where thousands of acres of green belt gets burnt off, all due to the callousness of human beings. We are working towards deforestation. How many of us bother to plant trees? So Pablo Neruda is making a huge positive statement and saying that when we freeze, okay, the few moments statue, what will happen? Imagine all the fishermen in the cold sea will stop attacking the whale. Now the fishermen here work as powerful symbol of the oppressor, and the whales can be termed as the oppressed. And we knew that in my introduction, I told you students that Pablo Neruda was always championing the cause of the ones who were oppressed. And he's trying to say that only when you pause for a few moments, only when you think what you're doing, and if we all are freezing for a few moments, children, imagine the relief to the life in the sea. The whales will not be attacked, and the man who is gathering his salt is also attacking the mineral resources thoughtlessly, going on and on and on. And we see it all around us in the environment, that, you know, there is enough for everyone's needs, but the environment is screaming and telling you, listen, human beings, there isn't enough for everyone's greed. And the man who is gathering the salt, what is he going to do? Even he's going to be a statue. So he will suddenly look at his hands and he's going to say, oh my God, all this time I thought I was benefiting. Symbolically trying to tell you that by attacking the resources, human beings feel that they are better off. But what are we doing? We are indirectly hurting our own selves. Children, all these flood channels are used for creating structures. We don't learn from our mistakes. We are building, we are destroying, we are destroying green belt. And if you remember the ailing planet in class 11, very nicely Nani Palkiwala said that, you know, in a second we are depleting acres of green belt, and that is the message being given to us. That can you imagine how much we are destroying? And are we being responsible then? Are we being the protectors of the generations who are coming? No. We know only three people in our lives today, the modern generation children. I, me and myself. It is my needs, it's my life. Are we worried about the fact that what are we leaving for the generations who are going to come tomorrow? He goes on to say, those who prepare green wars, wars with gas, wars with fire. And Pablo Neruda is trying to tell us the different kind of wars we have. Wars, green wars, students. What do you understand by green wars? Green wars is a reference to the attack on the green environment. Wars with chemical weapons, nuclear wars, people who are creating all kind of wars. He wants them to understand, human beings, wake up, look at the destruction. You can see the image of the blast, and till today, look what's happened. The two cities in Japan, Hiroshima and Nagasaki, they haven't restored their lives again. Even today, we read that mothers are giving birth to children who are not properly formed. And what about the Bhopal tragedy? We are using all kind of things in the name of development, but what are we doing? We are working towards a war. And believe you me, that if we do have a third war, world war, what is going to happen? What a beautiful line. Students, my favorite line in this poem, there will be a victory with no survivor. Pablo Neruda is trying to say that if you have a war today, yes, there will be a technical victory, but there is going to be no survivor. Imagine a nuclear war. One throws a nuclear bomb, the other one throws a nuclear bomb. Who is going to be, who's going to live on? And who's going to celebrate? So why cannot we delete this hugely negative thought, war, from our mind? And now, of course, this is also a beautiful usage of another poetic device called palilogia. When you have a repetition of the same word in the same sentence, children, war with green, war with this. The word war is repeated again and again. And what does that mean? This is a poetic device called palilogia. And he's saying that it is going to take us nowhere, because if we dare to even think of a war today, what is going to happen? We are going to have a so-called technical victory with no survivors. And it's so, what is his earnest request? What is his plea? What is he telling all of us? He is telling us that wear clean clothes and let us walk about with our brothers in the shade, doing nothing. For once, let us do nothing. Let us all wear clean clothes. What does he mean by clean clothes? Most of our clothes have stains of blood, not directly, have stains of blood metaphorically. These are the clothes which have witnessed death. These are the clothes which have witnessed harming others. And he says, for once, for God's sake, for once, let us shed these clothes. Let us all get into a white, a pure outfit. And what does that imply? Let us be peaceful, and let us walk hand in hand with all our brothers. And why? Because any other step today is going to be disastrous. I would say this poem is almost prophetic. There's an element of prophecy in it. 50 years back, Pablo Neruda left for the heavenly abode in 1973. And today, also this poem has huge relevance. When we talk about the destruction in different parts of the world, we wonder, oh my God, it is true. And that is what makes him so beautiful and makes his work so universal. So he says, let us do nothing. And now in the next stanza, he's going to specify that when I say let us do nothing, please do not misjudge me. I do not mean nothing as doing nothing at all, because life is all about being synonymous with doing something. So what I want should not be confused with total inactivity. Pablo Neruda is beautifully saying that please do not confuse my request to you with total inactivity. That is not what I am trying to say. What I am trying to tell you is just simply give a few moments of your day to a thought process, to meditation, to introspection, and find out why, what is your purpose in this life. I do not want total inactivity, he says. Why? Because life is what it is about. Life is synonymous with movement, students. If you stop doing things, who are the people who can't do anything? The people who are no more. He at no point of time wants to bring that message to you. And he says, I'm not talking about doing nothing. All I'm trying to say is pause. Freeze for a few moments. Statue, close. Close your eyes. Meditate for a few moments only. You have a huge day. You have hours to your benefit for other activities. But for God's sake, please contemplate and see which direction are you moving to. Are you moving to the right direction? And life is what it should be. And he very beautifully says, I want no truck with death. He says, at no given point of time, I'm saying be totally inactive. Why? Because even a few moments of introspection is basically doing something. You may not be using your hands and legs and your body and your thought process for something negative, but you are doing something positive. So life is all about its movement. And then as we proceed, we see that in what a mad rush we are going in. Everyone is thoughtlessly moving. Look at the crowds and the rushes. People are not thinking which direction are they going to. And if we were not so single-minded about keeping our lives moving, and for once we could do nothing, what would happen? Perhaps we could interrupt this huge silence of sadness. What is the sadness Pablo Neruda is talking about? Pablo Neruda is talking about living your entire life, students, and not knowing what have you come to this world for. How sad is that? There are millions of people across the world who never give even few moments in their life to think what their purpose in this world is. Is their purpose to destroy? Is their purpose to humiliate people? Is their purpose to attack, to steal, to cut the trees, to attack the resources? No. If you meditated for a few moments, you would exactly realize what is your purpose. And for months, it would interrupt this huge sadness. What is the sadness he's talking about? Please be very sure, children. The sadness which he is talking about is the sadness of living your entire life and not being able to understand what your purpose as a human being is on this earth, or never understanding that by doing these reckless things, what exactly are you achieving? You are actually threatening yourselves with death. We think we are being very smart, but doing every time we attack the nature, nature is not going to be complacent any longer. The world is not going to be complacent any longer. And today, if we are in an attacking mood, the environment and the world is also in a hugely attacking mood, and we do not want that. He says, if you need to live, please understand and don't work so thoughtlessly. And now look at these beautiful lines, and Pablo Neruda concludes his poem by an extended metaphor. And what is this extended metaphor? A metaphor is an indirect comparison. And students, in this image you will see the beautiful mountains covered with the snow. And what is the feel that you give? You get this feel of this quiet, serenity, calm, peace. Some people would term it as nature looks dead, but in actuality, it is not nature which is dead. But what is that? Nature is also in a few moments of contemplation, and nature is in a meditative mood. And what happens after that, students? It is not hidden. It is known by all of us that if winter be here, beautiful lines. I am reminded of P.B. Shelley in his Ode to the West Wind, where he also generates this kind of optimism. And so I told you that Pablo Neruda was also a die-hard optimist. And he says, so if winter be here, can spring be far behind? And that's exactly the comparison here, that when you see that earth can teach us, now this is personification. So who's your teacher? The earth is working as a teacher. And actually, you know, even William Wordsworth said, call nature the nurse, the guide, the soul of all my moral being. And students, nature and your mother's lap have always been your first teacher. So look around, look at the nature, and in winter, when nature appears to be dead and when nature appears to be totally calm and quiet, actually nature is in a meditative mode. And what comes after that meditation? Few moments of metaphorically, the winter works as a few moments of meditation for nature, and then we have beautiful spring. The colors, the celebration, the birds singing, the daffodils, the narcissus, the fragrance, the optimism, the positivity of the whole world comes alive. And this is what we need to learn, that what seems dead is actually not dead. And so he's trying to say, create a similar winter within yourself, because what will follow is going to be like this beautiful spring, totally energized, vibrant, beautiful, productive, lively. And after meditation, everything that you will do, students, every action which you'll do would have come after a huge thought process, and you will see the difference it'll make to your life, that you would have worked towards a positive life, you would have realized your purpose as a human being, and you would know only post meditation, a few moments, you would know that to make the world a better place, we need to stop attacking. We need to be in a mood of universal brotherhood. We need to feel the spirit amongst every human being. And finally, concluding the poem. So now I will count 12 and you will keep quiet and I will go. Pablo Neruda says that I am going to go. Perhaps he was trying to say that I will need to take on that eternal journey. I will go, but please understand that he's tried to convey this message to us, that the world is crying for some thought process. The nature is pleading and begging that for heaven's sake, have some mercy on me. And so now Pablo Neruda wants us to continue and to be indoctrinated with this wonderful idea that we need to meditate for a few moments to make this world a much better and a much more beautiful place. Now, students, in conclusion, let's quickly recapitulate the poetic devices and the few of the skills which Pablo Neruda used in the poem. Let's recapitulate. You can see it here. There is antithesis. I said the first line itself was an antithesis. There is personification. You can see where the Mother Earth has been termed as a teacher. There are symbols. You have the fisherman working as a symbol of the person who is exploiting, or should I say the aggressor versus the person who is attacked. And then you have a lot of other symbols. You have spring as a symbol of beauty and rejuvenation. You have winter can work as an extended metaphor, which works as a symbol of meditation. And then you have some of the new figures of speech. We spoke about palilogia. We spoke about the repetition of the word war with green, war with fire, war with chemicals. All the usage of the word war, amounting to palilogia. There was metonymy, the usage of the word language, which works as a symbol for a larger canvas, larger connotation. So the language can be taken at a much larger level, which could be the traits attributed to their different cultures, to the races, to the people's lives. And then, of course, the poem, like most of the modern poets, have used blank verse. So has Pablo Neruda used blank verse. Why has he used blank verse? He has used blank verse for the simple reason that it gives him a freedom. And we realized right in the beginning when we discussed the life of Pablo Neruda that he cherished freedom of speech. And unlike the poets of the 17th century who would write in heroic couplets, you know, it was kind of restrictive. So the modern poets firstly believe that they need this kind of freedom, freedom of speech to write what they have to, and a definite rhyme scheme normally limits the flow of the spontaneous flow of the feelings. And also another point to keep in mind why modern poets use blank verse, students, is because the modern world is termed to be a world which is so full of stresses and strains and confusion, and it's so broken up, it's so fragmented and divided that there is no melody in it. In fact, what you find all around is what you can term as cacophony, and hence they write in blank verse because there is no rhythm in modern world with all these war threats, with all these attacks, with all this ruthlessness. People have begun, and I am always reminded of the great novel, the one of my favorite novels, Lord of the Flies, where Golding says, another Nobel laureate says that, you know, human beings are the worst form of animals, and if we scratch the veneer of our skins, we are really bad animals. So unless we are governed by tough laws and we enter into dialogues, we will not spare each other. And unfortunately, it is very saddening and disheartening, but we do see this kind of spirit prevailing across the world today. Thank you very much. I am done with my lecture. I hope you have enjoyed listening to this lecture as much as I have enjoyed communicating and connecting with you today. Thank you, students, and have a wonderful day.